Welcome to Retouch Pro Live, the only live talk show dedicated to retouching and image post-processing. I'm your host, Doug Nelson. Welcome to our third audience showcase show, the show where I let the inmates run the asylum for a little while. Let me show said inmates how they can run said asylum. You should see a panel looking similar to this. If you don't see this lower part, go to the questions, click on the little arrow here. It might be a plus sign depending on your operating system. Type your question in here and hit send. That's all there is to it. Can I get some shout outs? Can I get some people showing me that this is indeed working, that there are indeed alive people out there listening to me? You can just type in any gobbledygook you choose. You can say hi. You can say A, B, C, D, E, F. Anything you would like, just to know, just let me know that, yes, this thing is communicating. Let me see here. I guess you'll also want to know how to upload. We already have several very fascinating looking uploads, but I know some people always wait until the last minute. I really wish they wouldn't, but hey, I can't stop them, and it's perfectly fine. I will paste the upload link in right now. You can also see it right here on your screen. Don't forget to read the rules. The most critical one being, of course, renaming the file to include your name. Especially today, for the viewer, for the audience showcase shows, because I am the only one here, and if I can't find a given file, then you have to sit there listening to silence while I search for it. And I know that makes for thrilling showmanship, but please help me out there. Also, be aware that the show is recorded, so don't upload anything that you do not want to see mercilessly commented upon by the YouTube commenters from now on. Speaking of our YouTubers, welcome. I am pleased to have you here. Do me a favor, hit subscribe and the little thumbs up icon under the screen. If you're not familiar with RetouchPro.com, why don't you come on by, say hi. We actually have a little sub-forum specifically for newcomers to say hello and get to know each other, and you'll learn why RetouchPro.com is the warmest, most welcoming, and supportive place for retouchers and Photoshop enthusiasts anywhere. And I'm not even going to qualify that, because that is an absolute truth. Let's see here, speaking of RetouchPro.com, don't forget while you are there to check out our videos. These are different from our YouTube shows. These are very in-depth. Most of them are start-to-finish real-time retouch jobs from some of the industry's most in-demand retouchers. You'll see beauty retouching and automotive and product and jewelry and photo restoration and HDR and 3D and, there's a bunch of other stuff there. Although most of the shows are very advanced, and all of them are at least 2 hours, some of them almost 3 hours long, there are some more basic shows for people wanting to brush up on their rudimentary skills. We got a request last week for a smart object show, and I got all excited and ran it by Steve Kaplan, and he said, well, we already have that. We've got the most detailed smart object show anyone could ever want to see already up on the video site. So go to retouchpro.com/videos. Check these out. I think you will be impressed. While you are there, up to the site nav menu, go to Be a Patron and consider becoming a patron for Retouch Pro. This is actually how we pay our bills. Believe it or not, the advertising on the site and the percentage commission I get on the videos and all that other stuff does not pay for the site. The site is, or these shows, these audience showcase shows, or even the other shows we're doing, it is all paid for by our patrons. And if you think, oh, well, that's okay, I'm sure he gets enough patron subscriptions to pay for this plus a little bit, I'm safe. No, that's not the case. Last month in total, we got three. That's three total patron subscriptions, which, while I am very grateful to those people, and thank you so much if you are watching right now, and I'm sure you are enjoying the many benefits that accrue to the patronage subscribers, that's not nearly enough. Honestly, my savings are almost gone. The funds that I had set aside for this little project have just about evaporated. We got more going out every month than coming back in. I really need your help. I'd hoped to get some sponsorship for the shows. It seemed to be me to be a slam dunk that like an X-Rite or a Wacom or an Epson or an NVIDIA or somebody like that would want to sponsor these shows, show their goodwill to the community, show their support to the community, say thank you to the community. But every time I contact these people, the only thing they want to know is how many thousands of people per day view these shows. Whenever I give them the actual figures, which is some of these shows have not been seen by 1,000 people yet, I never hear from them again. So, yes, I really need you to do the patronage if you can possibly afford it. Now, I'm aware that not everybody is rolling in the dough like I am. So if you can't, just plain old can't afford a patron subscription, or I also know I got a couple comments last month that for whatever reason, some people choose not to register for the site, and you do need to be a registered member to become a patron. I don't know, maybe you want to give even more than the patron, or for whatever reason, you don't want to become a patron, but you would still like to support the show, you can use PayPal to send any amount of fundage from the smallest amount to the largest amount that you would like to PayPal@retouchpro.com. That's actually important enough that I will paste that in now. For you to save that for later. Put it in your pocket. Tell your rich friends. If I can get 10 patrons this month, not today, just this month, I will promise that we will have another showcase show next month. And then I will give everybody a state of the RetouchPro.com statement at that time, and we'll just go month to month until X-Rite or Wacom or Epson or whoever, NVIDIA, I'm looking at you, comes to their senses and realizes that they really need to support the show. Hey, maybe lynda.com, stranger things have happened. Or if just a rich person is that enjoys this is watching and would like to support us for 1 month or whatever, Give me a holler. Everything is negotiable. I want to keep this thing going, but it is not a bottomless fund of money, and it is running out. We only have enough left for another month or two unless we get some additional support. Okay, sorry to bum you out like that, but it would have been dishonest of me not to tell you about that. Let's see here. We've got a lot of beautiful thumbnails. I'm starting to get the hang of this, okay? This is only our third audience showcase show, and I try a few different things first time, a few different things the second time. I'm going to try a few different things this time. Got a different sorting system. Believe it or not, I feel rather awkward stammering and umming and erring while I'm looking for somebody's image, and so I'm trying different ways of doing that. If somebody would like to volunteer to go first, feel free to type in right now and give me your name and the name of the file that you would like us to look at first, and then we will just take it from there. Let me close these screens to get prepared. We have our first Volunteer, let me see, and here's where I and while I am looking for the images. I know I saw that earlier. Where is it? And let's see, this is where, here we go. No? Where are you? Greg, what'd you name your image? I know I saw this here earlier. Yes, I know I saw it. Oh, maybe this, oh, there we go. Oh, I like this. Okay, guys. This is the before. A perfectly nice, very nice image. And here is the after. Okay, guys. What do you think of what Greg's done to our angel here? I'm just going to sit here until somebody types something in. Greg says the title of this is called Angel Dancer. John says, excellent job. John points out she put on some weight, which is, there's nothing wrong with that, but it does run contrary to industry standards. Interesting. Or could that, could just be, could we have a ratio problem here? I don't know. This is Greg's wife, so watch what you say. He did this for a portfolio piece, for both her portfolio and his. That's nice. Malcolm says, nice job, but does look stretched width-wise. Okay. Greg, you need to watch out for that because more than one person is commenting on that. Crawford wants me to toggle some more so we can appropriately appreciate the width difference. I like the little cupids in the corners there. You have a very attractive wife. Greg, the hard line at the bottom, which I'm assuming we're talking about this, but that's part, there's a frame here. So that, is that what we're talking about, or is it, are we talking about even further down here? And that is from John's. And Larry says, very well done, but not sure about the rectangle and drop shadow around the angel. I don't know. I kind of like that, but... I can appreciate it that that is a look that some people might not like. Greg says, no, there's nothing stretched. That's exactly the way he wanted it to appear. So, hey, that is great. John says, beautiful lady. Greg points out that the corner images here are cherubs, not cupids, which I'll assume that that's an important point to someone. I think... Greg did a wonderful job. Are these bird wings that you spliced on here, or did you draw those? That's an interesting... I don't know if there's a bird wing filter out there or something. Those are stock images he bought off the web. See how much better things are whenever the artist is in the audience. I think that's wonderful. Ryan says, just wondering about the feet in the original. Has something already been done there? Doesn't look natural, but works in the final. So Brian's complaining about the original, although that is kind of odd looking. Yeah, her tootsies do seem to be kind of hanging off in the space there, although I don't really, it looks like there's some cloning going on here. I don't think that really matters. But he says it doesn't matter in the final, so... all in all, everyone seems to be very... appreciative. Greg says the foot was replaced is why it looks like that. Derek says overall is a great image, but it's very digitally clean. If it has a little bit of texture globally, it will blend much better. This is actually a point that has been coming up more and more frequently in our shows. If you add a film grain layer or a noise layer, or I know Steve Kaplan likes to add a grunge layer, although that might be a bit dated. I don't really think it would be appropriate on here. But I could see maybe like a parchment or a stucco or something like that. Let's see. Eleanor says, great work. However, the sharp lines emanating from the left shoulder seem somewhat distracting. I think he's talking about the rays here. She's talking about the rays here, which are also over here, but her hair hides it here. I don't know about that. Although I will say that I like it here. So maybe they could be a little bit softer. I don't know. Greg says this is actually not a new image, and the textures and all that came into vogue after he did this. Let's see here. Crawford says the background within the frame should be offset slightly from the rest of the background. Now, here I think I understand what he's talking about, in that the frame here is saying that it lines up too perfectly, and if you just made it like a little bigger or a little bit more to the left, a little bit more to the right, I would say maybe a little bigger, I'm thinking. I was just thinking that maybe that might help a little bit. Let's see here. I think we have pretty much run this one into the ground. Great image there, Greg. Congratulations on your wife there. Who is going to volunteer for being next? Now that they see how mercilessly we carve into these things here. Let's see here. If no one else volunteers, I know I saw him in the audience here. Let's dive into Larry Vogel's just because the thumbnail looked interesting to me. I haven't, that's one of the things that I did differently this time, is I have not gone in and previewed all of these before the show, so I am seeing these full size now for the first time, just like everyone else is. Just so I could keep it fresh for myself. And it's worked out that this was a very interesting thumbnail. Larry says he's open for a beating. Okay, he's daring us here. Greg says neat, which is succinct but appropriate. The first thing that strikes me, and it could be deliberate, but it strikes me as a little distracting, is the symmetricality of this. Aside from our guru or whoever that is lying there, or let's just say he's meditating or whatever, everything is a straight horizontal mirror, and I just thought it might have a little bit more visual interest if it was varied a little bit more. Greg seems to agree with me. I kind of wish that these lines here were straight as opposed to bent down, although I'm sure they were bent down in reality. Right now it just says, hey, look, this is where I mirrored this point. And I know it's not really fair to have your work criticized on an artistic basis by people that use Photoshop daily, and so they know all the Photoshop effects and artifacts and everything, whereas the casual viewer would have who has no knowledge of Photoshop would not be aware of something like this. Hey, you came here, you uploaded. I'm assuming this is the kind of input you're looking for. John says the grass should go under the person as well. Steve Kaplan actually had a really neat technique for blending grass. Go look at some of his early shows up on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/retouchpro. I think his first and second shows, he has a really neat grass blending technique that works out really well. Let's see here. Derek says the background is a literal mirror. That's interesting. So we're looking back at us. How deep. Interesting. See, it looks like they're indentations that go towards the back. Not 100% certain what that means, but I'll just throw that out there for what it's worth. Let's see here. As far as the overall image, like I got to stop saying I'm a fan. I rewatched our first show and I found that I said I'm a fan about 20 times, and I really, really hate it whenever I get stuck like that. But I do think it's an interesting image. I think it would be more interesting It would be interesting on the second look and the third look and the fourth look if there was more complexity to it, if there was less symmetricality, if the symmetricality was a little tricky, if there was maybe just like another layer there, if maybe the clouds vaguely formed other shapes, things along those lines. And if there weren't so many cues as to what was going on with the Photoshopery so that that wasn't a distraction. Eleanor says she really likes the mirrored symmetrical background, but the cows would have been a nice way to break the symmetry instead of add to it. I can see that. Maybe have exactly the same cows except one of them with a mouthful of grass or something. Larry defends himself by saying the clouds are not symmetrical. Okay, it's news to me. They look symmetrical. We've got this cloud here, we've got this cloud here, we've got these clouds here, we've got these clouds here. I can see some differentiation up here at the top, but very, very, very little. And I know these are different clouds than these different clouds over here, but they look almost like exactly the same cloud. I'm not trying to be harsh on you or whatever, I'm just saying that this is the what people are seeing, and if you want to get your artistic impulse across, you have to remove the obstacles and the barriers. And if you're showing your work to a bunch of Photoshop experts and enthusiasts, the first thing you're going to have to remove are the telltale Photoshop signs. Let's see here. Derek says, if you squint your eyes and you can see the symmetry of the clouds on the bottom, but the top are different. Greg says the brightest clouds are symmetrical. Maybe that's what's going on. Maybe it's just the brightest ones, and so this is a pure happenstance. I'm also wondering, and this was one of my first impulses, is was that smoke? Are those clouds? Because this starts out clear and realistic, but then gets cloudy really fast. And then so I have to wonder the meaning here. But, again, I like this a lot. I know you didn't have anything to do with it other than the photography, but I love this texture going on here in this work. It would have been interesting if maybe something that could have been brought about. Or, I don't know, maybe you did do that. I don't know. Anyway, Larry, thank you so much for sharing. I hope we weren't too terribly hard on you there. Who is going to volunteer to be next? We need a new victim. Derek says he wants to go next. Here we go. This is Derek's before. I don't really know what to do here because they're both labeled before, Derek. That's before. That's also before. Did you upload two befores and no after? Where's the after, Derek? Let's see here. The after is later on. Sorry for the dead air, folks. I'm looking for Derek's after in my pile of photos here. And Derek, I am not seeing the after. Can you upload your after real fast for us? Because we have two befores here and no after. We're getting some critiques on your before, but that's not really sporting now, is it? Go ahead and re-upload your after, and we'll come back to it next. Let's see here. Who is going to volunteer to go in the middle here? Oh, wait. Wait, guys. Oh, now, hi, Derek, I have to say this is pretty incredible because in your before, we have an African-American couple, and in your after, you have turned them to an Asian couple. So this is a remarkable before and after. And they are now standing, what, at a power station? I'm giving you grief here because I think an error was made somewhere along the lines. And I'm still waiting for somebody else to volunteer to fill the... okay, Crawford, what did you name your image? Because I am not seeing a Crawford here. There we go. This is Crawford's image. No, this is Brent's image. Brent, sorry about that. This, you know, I have no assistant here. I am doing this solo, so apologies for the confusion. But this is Brent Chambers. Is this the only one, Brent? Is this the before and the after? Or do we tear into this one? This looks... Did you send a similar one to a previous one? Because, I don't know, the fisher person here does not look familiar, but these water ripples certainly do. Or maybe I'm thinking of the koi fish. Yeah, there was a koi fish image. I don't know if it was yours or not, but in the previous show that had a very similar. No, he says no, this is Brent's very first submission. So what do we think of Brent's photo here, besides I wish I was there, which is what I'm thinking myself. Is this a straight photo, or is this Brent, or is there some manipulation going on here? We're just waiting for people to have feedback for Brent. I have to say, I wish there might be a... Is this a... is there a change in depth here? Is this... I guess not. Maybe if this was more obvious here, I'm going to say. Crawford says, nice shot. Would like to see more color. Possibly. Maybe in the water especially. I could see that. But then again, that also might have been part of the point. I really like... this part right here. I mean, I like the overall image, but I like this. Having been a fisher person of my own in the past, I have to wonder about this particular person's technique. But then again, it might not be part of the point of the thing. Larry says, love the watercolor and details. The figure could use better shadow detail. Greg says, what is he holding? I have to assume that's a fishing rod, although, Brent, you can feel free to correct me if that's not the case. Joseph says, eye-catching, like the water, looks realistic, which is convenient if this is a real non-CGI image. Let's see here. Brent says, yes, he's standing on a ledge, only just higher than the water. Then maybe if there's a way to... do something with this line here, maybe sharpen it or darken it or blur it or something. I don't know. This is yours. Brent says, it's pretty sure it's a homemade fishing rod. This was taken at the Corniche in Beirut. So I'm guessing this person is, if that's the case, this person is probably a much more experienced fisher person than I am, since this person is probably fishing for their dinner rather than sport. About the only comment I have myself is this little line here. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it. It just looks like it might be a missed opportunity here. I'm thinking you could have done something with that to add to the depth, to make the image not quite so flat. Derek says, I like the stream of water, but the image leading from the man to the fishing rod, but it stops there. If there was a fish or something to anchor the viewer, then it would be even more powerful. I'm sure the fisher person agrees with that. Greg says, a vignette would help with all the empty space, especially the top left. I'm always a big vignette. It looks like there is a slight vignette here. I'm a big fan of edge burn, although that's showing my age. knowing that I come from the Ansel Adams era, I think just about every image could use some degree of edge burn, maybe not even a visible degree of edge burn. But I think it just adds to the focus, particularly if it's going to be mounted. That's kind of an obsolete concept in the era of screen viewing and web viewing and things along those lines. But I think a little bit of edge burn adds to the subconscious drama of just about image. Let's see here. Brent says he agrees on the vignetting. He's going to take that into consideration. Yeah, Greg says a vignette would help with all the empty space, especially at the top left. Our eyes are going all over the photo. And I think that's actually a pretty good point there. It's an interesting image, but it looks more travel-loggy than arty. It looks more like, it looks very natural, National Geographic, which is, an exceedingly high compliment. But that tends to be part of a photo essay rather than standalone images. Standalone images we tend to judge on their arty content. And you can't necessarily have an eye aimlessly wandering with arty content. Greg says there's really nothing of interest in the corners, and so go ahead and make them darker. And I'm going to just say consider burning the whole thing. So it also would give this more of a sense of moment. So I would wonder what this would look like with a little bit of edge burn, something going on here, sharpening, softening, darkening, lightening. I don't know, just something to exaggerate this line, this lip here, to make it look like there's something going on, even if it really wasn't there, since we've pretty much, at least in my mind, dispensed with any sort of concept of editoriality on this. And I'm seeing, I don't know, that's interesting. Are those sparkles here? Maybe those could be brought out. Is that paper? I don't really know. I'm just now noticing that. First of all, I love this right here, this little transition right here. This is gorgeous. And then extending down here. So I'm seeing this right here. Okay, here we have one artistic vector, shall we call it. I don't even know if that's really a thing. And that actually goes all the way down here. Here we have another one, kind of champagne-y, kind of New Year's Eve-y. And we've got another one here. Then we've got some little microcosms here. There's just a lot going on. So if you just did one or two things, don't take anything away, but just to kind of like say, this is the one I want you to look at, or something like that. Brent says those are actually thousands of little fish. Wow. If there was a way to bring those out, maybe if there was an photo editing app that could actually make things larger, could actually take these pixels and make them larger, that would be great if we had access to something like that. Oh, pardon the sarcasm there. That's undeserved. Yeah, make the fish bigger. That is marvelous. If we could see those were fish, go ahead and lose a lot of them. Just, double, triple them in size, whatever. That would be marvelous. Like I say, since we have dispensed with the concept of editoriality, at least for the purposes of this discussion, if we could see and register those as fish rather than as like paper grain or something, that would be marvelous. While you're at it, why don't you give them a line or something here? I don't know. I'm just thinking out loud here. But that is not to detract from your original photo. It is a striking photo, and I think a good job. And congratulations on going to Beirut. That's definitely one up on me. Thank you, Brent. All right, who is going to be next on the chopping block? We had, let's see here, we had a couple of volunteers. We had M.M. Chambers. This is Brent again? No. Is this a different Chambers? We have multiple Chambers here. This could be Beiruti again. Oh, yes, feel free to comment. Is this another one of yours, Brent, or is this, I could have sworn there was another. They've already scrolled up off the screen. Oh, this is the parental unit of Brent. Either Mrs. or Mr. Chambers. So this is a different Chambers. First thing I gotta say, wonderful, wonderful image, but The first thing that went through my head is the whole thing is leaning towards the right. And yes, that's the first comment we got, is the building looks tilted. Brian says the eye is drawn to the vertical on the right. There's a lot of verticals on the right. I guess he's talking about the border here. I don't know. Apologies if that is an artistic statement or whatever, or if the building really is leaning over here, but it looks like all of these buildings, I don't know, or it actually looks like it could be keystone distortion. So it says all the buildings actually are leaning towards the right. This was at Alt Ben Hadou, an ancient city in Morocco. Wow, the Chambers family gets around. Good job, Chambers. Crawford wants to know, was much retouching at all done on this? Larry suggests cropping or changing the sky to add more interest. I might see the sky part a little bit, although when you're doing something like this, you know, you're torn between memorializing the you are there aspect of the thing, and also, again, like we mentioned in the last image, the arty part of the thing. And so, you know, if you say, you know, I was there, the buildings really were slanted, the sky really was gray, then great. That is for your album. That is for the Christmas slideshow or whatever. For an audience showcase show, you might want to consider straightening the buildings or adding some contrast to the sky. Greg says, the walkway creates a leading line to the subjects, but the building seems to be drawing the most attention. That's actually a good point. The subjects ostensibly should be the two people in there, since we are people and they are people, and we should feel a connection there. And they're framed and everything, but the buildings are getting all the comments from the audience. So realistic or not realistic, the buildings are actually detracting from the image, unless you're trying to make a comment about life in Morocco and how they're about to be crushed by buildings or something. I don't know. Brian also suggests a darker foreground, back to the edge burn thing, and this is purely my own bias, folks. Take this for what it's worth. A little bit of edge burn can help in just about any situation. Let's see, I've never done this before. Let's try Steve Kaplan's favorite edge burn technique. He likes going into camera raw, and where is it? Into the camera. Camera calibration? Help me out here, folks. Where is the vignetting fix that in camera raw? Under lens manual, lens vignetting. There we go. This is a technique it's not just Steve Kaplan, it's a lot of people. They enjoy using this. But just you can see a little bit, you don't even really want it to be visible. You want it to be more of a subconscious thing. And this is just one technique. My own favorite technique is to make an adjustment layer. You can do, let's do this fancy, do a solid color, white, or no, let's leave it at black, and then do a radial fill of the, let's inverse real fast. You can see why I have other people doing my primary shows. And then lower the opacity and change the blend mode overlay and all sorts of neat things like this. But you can just see there are things here, maybe multiply or darken. Nah, that looks bad. How about darken? That looks better. And let's not do the fill, let's do the opacity here. any number of different techniques. Soft light has been okay, a soft light. Everybody has their own favorite one. That's just another technique. There's a million ones. There's going to be a different technique for every possible person in the audience, but just basically try it. You can also just paint it for many, many years. That's the way I used it. I just took an incredibly soft black brush on a new layer. I actually painted outside the image so that just the feathered part of the brush, and that way you can do an asymmetrical burn, and then, like I say, you lighten it so that it's only subconsciously visible. Let's see here. Yeah, Yakov says gradient on a mask and stretch it out. There's any number of ways, but the important part is to consider that. But I think the important takeaway for this particular image is wonderful image. Take me with you the next time you go to Morocco and consider perhaps maybe straightening this building. Give it a try and maybe doing something with the sky to give it a little bit more interest. And then real quickly, Crawford says, I think it needs deeper shadows. The walk-up pattern is fairly low contrast. All the buildings are too close at their levels. Yakov says those leaves are distracting. Well, I can see that they're distracting, but they also kind of add to the verisimilitude of the image. I might even take them out and make them bigger and move them down or something. I don't know. Greg says he wishes they were greener. Interesting. Yakov says he wishes they were yellow. So you can see there's, as per many, many, many things in life, there are as many as there are viewers. But anyway, thank you, Chambers Major, for sharing that. And another one of those cases of I wish I was there. I hope some of these comments will give you and everyone else some food for thought for their other images. Let's see here. Derek says he sent in his file. I got to tell you, the uploads are incredibly slow, so it's possible that I do not have it yet. But let's go to James Dean. This is the original. And here we have James's after. Now, just purely coincidentally, James emailed me, and I said to myself I was not going to say anything about this unless he was present. But he says, first, he posterizes the photos to 26 colors. He expands the results to a size specified by vertical and horizontal height in inches and vertical and horizontal dots per inch. And he merges each area of color below a specified size with the adjacent area of color nearest in color. This is what YouTube is for later after on, you guys. Then he blends colors at the boundaries and the areas of color. Then he adds simulated brush strokes to the areas of color. The result is an example of digital pictorialism. So that's what we have here. He did the image, and then he added the brush strokes. Again, we'll start with the before, which is that the Blue Ridge Mountains. That looks, of course, a lot of mountains look the same, but that looks a bit like the Blue Ridge Mountains. And then here we have the after. What is everybody thinking of James's image? Let's see here. Malcolm says, Monet? Question mark. Greg says, what are the circular lines? I got to assume that that's the part of the brushstroke effect that James was talking about. James says, this is the Powell Valley overlook near Norton, Virginia. So I wasn't too terribly far off, only like by a state. Yakov recommends doing similar results from scratch using the mixer brush. Let's see here. Phil says, recommends the cutout filter might do the same. John says the mountains are too light in tone. Yakov says it's a neat effect overall. Greg says the background mountains are too bland. Tom says the mixer brush does a better job. We're getting a couple of votes that, yes, they like it, except they don't like the way you did it. So we're getting political here. John says looks too much like a Buzz Pro filter, but nice. Yeah, this is a common theme for all of these audience showcase shows. As soon as you start, whether it, you know, a common culprit is Topaz, but as soon as people start throwing around accusations of running a filter on it, then I think you've already lost the argument, because it's like the falling over buildings. They're going to be thinking about that, not about what the photo is of. Malcolm says the watercolor filter. So a lot of people are saying, pretty, but I would have done it this way. Pretty, but I would have done it this way. Pretty, but I would have done it this way. Brian says, nice. He did not like the original, which he think needed more on the right, but he likes the result and thinks the crop now works. So now that is a positive criticism. That says you have actually improved on things, which is kind of, I suspect, your point. I see no cropping at all, but you can do wonders with tone and color. Especially, he's darkened it over here in this corner, and I think that's grounded a lot more. To be honest, Larry says, not a big fan of these images. The technique is more interesting than the results. Now, that might be why everybody is throwing their 2 cents in on how they would have done it. Because it is, as Larry says, perhaps it is a case where the technique is more interested in the results. So there we get into, you know, what are we trying to say here? Are there any other layers of meaning, or is this just a pretty picture? Yeah. Now, unfortunately, some negative comments are starting to come in. Eleanor says it has a bit of a paint by number quality to it. So I don't really know if these are constructive, but it definitely lets you know the read of the audience. So is the end result more than the original beyond the autopsy that we are, or the post, not an autopsy, the post-mortem that we are doing here on how the heck did he do it? And then once we've solved that mystery, then that's really all there is for us there. James wanted to show this because he said he actually wrote the program that simulated the paint by number. And so you are not insulting his Photoshop skills. You are insulting his programming skills, which James, if you program this, I am impressed, because I have tried programming many, many times, not necessarily in the Photoshop area, but I suck at that. So yeah, so now people are a little bit more. A little bit more appreciative now that they know the actual amount of the weight on your shoulders when you were doing this. So the actual image itself, people seem to be, unfortunately, rather nonplussed by, James. But the effort that you put into it, especially now that you have underscored the amount of effort, that has impressed people. So I don't know. Take from that what you will. Which, by the way, this image has nothing to do with nothing, but this is a lovely histogram. I mean, that histogram, you could frame that histogram. I have never seen anything like that before, which might have something to do with the mechanical nature of this image, but that's not even the real histogram. That's the cached histogram, but I'm afraid to click on it to refresh because that is so kind of pretty. Anyhow, James, I hope we were of some use to you. Thank you for sharing. I wish I knew how to program. I got a bunch of stuff I could get done if I knew how to program. Let's see here. We have David Higley wants to volunteer. Where is David's image? We have, oh, here we go. This is interesting. This is a photo restoration. Or will be once it finally agrees to open. There we go. This is the before. assume. Here we have the after. And I will do David the favor of hiding his guide there. So let's... what do we think of David's restoration here? I'm going to say it needs a sky, David. It really does need a sky. I know there's not one in the image, but coming from a photo restoration background, I got to say, I kept some skies around. I even tried, there was a couple of sky plugins. They didn't really work, but just the sky, there was a sky there. The film wasn't sensitive enough to capture it, so you're not being dishonest. Throw a sky in there. Make sure you do it and then paste some grain over it so that it matches. But that will enhance the image and keep people from nitpicking on every little detail. Like, for example, there is a because the sky is blown out, that makes the whole image seem lighter and higher contrast than it actually is. John says, needs some saturation on the man's hair and face. Although, unfortunately, that's the case of a lot of photo restorations because there's only so much data there before you start getting into the realm of painting, which is where I personally drew the line. Derek says, the right eye of the man seems weird on the after. Again, it's, you know, there's really no data there, although in that case you might have been able to copy the other eye and swap it and don't use it as the original, but maybe like overlay it at a lower opacity to give a more of a suggestion of a total eye. Let's see here. Brent says, great work controlling the tone shifts and especially the reconstruction on the left side. Yes, if you look at her skirt, there's actually some dramatic work going on there. James suggests the guy in the original was wearing glasses, which might explain quite a bit. Let's see. Was he wearing some of those FDR glasses? I really can't tell, but it's very possible that that could be the bridge of some of those frameless glasses that were so popular back then. It's one of the fun things about these is doing your little bit of forensic investigation and trying to find out why did they have their picture taking? Are they an errant millionaire and his wife, or are they standing in front of their nondescript gravesite, or is this the parents of somebody that hired them, or what the heck's going on? Or is this a random image from eBay, which is the case in a lot of mine? Let's see here. There's a blob on the left side of his face. Much details. Unfortunately, it looks like a lot of people are being sidetracked by the side of the face. A lot of the comments are talking about the side of the face. And so if you're going to concentrate on any one thing, first of all, I think if there was a sky in the image, they might not be picking on the face quite so much. But that seems to be the area that everyone thinks needs the greatest sense of attention. David says this is his wife's parents on their honeymoon. In these old photos, and this was, I agonized over this myself, and a lot of times there is actually no data, and it is especially harmful in a face because we are so very sensitive to the way faces look, and so you have to say to yourself, do I just reinforce the ugly blockiness that is there, or do I try to get artistic and try to save a little bit and perhaps change the person's personality a little bit? But that is a judgment call. But it looks like you are 90-95% of the way there. You might want to consider, like I say, the sky. If you can't actually draw faces, which I can't draw or paint faces to save my life, then maybe try stealing some from this side and overlaying it at a lower opacity just to lend a suggestion. And then maybe consider the overall contrast might be just a tad high, especially in the highlights. The collar's blown out here. In reality, it would not be blown out, things along those lines. Let's see here. Okay, David, I hope we were of some use to you. Thank you for submitting. Who's our next willing victim? Let's see here. Crawford says, see, Crawford, well, I can't find your image. That's why I ask you people to upload beforehand, because the upload is ridiculously slow on this thing. Crawford, what did you name your image, Crawford? Okay, we got a couple of people volunteering to. I'm going to have to come up with a better. Trouble is, I can't sort them by name because you guys are so nuts with your different naming conventions. Even with the same image, and so if I sort by name, then it throws them on different ends. I got to find a better sorting technique. Here we go. Okay, here's Crawford's image. Thank you for your patience, everyone. Okay, I know what the first couple of comments are going to be on this one, but let's see the before. And here is Crawford's after. Before, after. Looks a little bit more like John Goodman in the after, I think. Okay, my first comment, while everyone else is typing in, and I know you're going to say no fair because there's nothing really in the original, is there's nothing here. Now, maybe this is a artistic statement, or maybe you're planning on using Lee Veris's technique to overlay him on the the Indy 500. He looks like an Indy fan, or something along those lines. So maybe we are not looking at the completed image here, but if we are looking at the completed image, you could really use something of interest here. Larry comments also that he, especially with all this gray, he doesn't know if he needs all that space above the top of his head. We're getting a couple of comments about the shadows being too dark, which, again, if you would have overlaid this on virtually any other image, palm trees, garage shelf. I only say that because the shirt looks a little bit garagey to me, although it's a polo shirt. But Greg also says, and if if this is a self-portrait, I apologize, but he says a tighter crop would have taken pounds off. So do not take that in any other spirit other than the spirit that it was intended. Brent compares it to the dragon effect, which is similar to what I thought was going to be comment. First comment was HDR, which is the it's similar to what I thought was going to come. I thought the first comment was going to be topaz, which has been kind of the clarion call of our past couple of shows. Now, see, this image here, this is a very nice image. It's very soft, but it has all the details. This is an excellent portrait. Now we go into this. Now this is obviously more stylized. You meant something to, you know, you wanted to say something here, but what are you saying? This looks like a sweet man. This looks like a man I would want to have a beer with. This looks like a man who would know a couple of really bad dad jokes. This man looks like he's holding a crowbar behind his back. This man looks like maybe John Goodman's before pick. This is what he looked like before he went into makeup, before Roseanne filmed or something along those lines. Now, this very well could be the look you're going for. And if it is, congratulations, but I suspect this might not necessarily be the look you are going for. Crawford says this is a shot of one of our company executives. Apologies if this company exec is watching on YouTube. We certainly mean no negative comments. In your unretouched state, you are a very pleasant-looking gentleman. I have to wonder, though, this gray is just bugging me. Is that a style choice, or is this prep for something else? And my mind is going a mile a minute. If this is a style choice, why did you leave all the space here? Bunch of questions there. So I got to say, take this exact image and go watch the Lee Veris show up on YouTube. Lee Veris hair masking show. This is his hair masking technique. He puts it on a gray background, and then he uses the blending modes and puts that allows him to put it on just about any blend, any other background you would like. And you could put some corporate bookshelves here, or a million customers. I don't know what kind of customer, what kind of company this is. There was a couple of weeks there where this exaggerated facial feature technique was very, very popular. You've done a very good job of it. That's what you're going for. Personally, I think it looks a little dated myself. But if that was the effect you were going for, good job on that. Larry says, not great for an executive shot. It does portray a tougher look than a corporate look. So if that's what you were going for, congratulations, good job. I got to say also, the shirt doesn't quite match his face. If you're going to give his face that exaggerated look, you need to do the same thing on his shirt a little bit. I don't know. And I got to say, even in this look, you might want to soften this one little touch under the eye here. If nothing else, just to make it more symmetrical. Okay. Does anyone else have anything before we say goodbye to Crawford? Okay. Thank you so much, Crawford. I hope, again, take this in the spirit in which it is intended. Let's see here. Okay. I know we had a couple of volunteers, but there were so many comments recently that they have now scrolled off the top of the screen. And let's see, who else is going to volunteer? Phil. Yeah, we can always count on Phil. Oh, that's interesting. I have my setup wrong. It didn't open in Photoshop. Fascinating. This is a ping file. Fascinating. What are we going to say here? You didn't upload your before, did you, Phil? I don't see it. Wow, this is very Johnny Mnemonic. This is very William Gibson. I got to say, I like those plugs in her hair. Might have made them a little smaller, simply because I know what those plugs look like in real life, but I think that's a nifty effect. Yakov says, holy blending mode. Phil volunteers that this is five different images in a collage. If this is a CD cover for a very angry electronic band, I think you've done a very good job. Brent says, this looks like a Dave McKean illustration. Excellent, which I have to say, I don't know who Dave McKean is, but take that for what it's worth. Larry says, very cool look, but perhaps crop the 1/8-inch bright edges. Although, I don't know. I think those edges might be intentional. I don't know. Are they, or is that an accident? I saw it, and I saw it as an echo of this edge and an echo of this edge, and I just thought that was intentional. So, Phil, secretly, was that intentional? And if it was, you might want to crop it, although that would also crop these numbers up here. But in public, of course, you can say, that's exactly what I intended it to look like, and I wanted to do that. And we'll go, uh-huh, and humor you. Fascinating. I know you didn't upload the before, but I kind of would have liked to have seen the before of her. Phil volunteers that he likes the edges, except on the top. Now, that's interesting. So he thinks it needs more of these edges. And I can see that it looks like it tried. Yeah, I can actually see that. And if anybody has spent any time at all trying to fix a circuit board, you can see that circuit boards actually have the edges and like that because they are made from a photolithography technique. Oh, I just now noticed this little target here. I love that. There's a lot of little things here. You can see this is the Indian picture of the guru we had early from somebody entirely different. You can see the difference in the reaction, not because of the quality, not because of the way things are looking, but because of the depth and the things that, I can see that. Oh, now look, I'm looking at this. And you come back and you'll see something that you didn't see before. This is what we're talking about as far as the complexity. You can love it, you can hate it, but you can't look away and you can't not see little things new every time. Phil, I gotta say you did a good job. Not getting a lot of comments on it. That could be jealousy, or it could just be that we've reached the 1 hour mark and a lot of people have had to leave, which I do know is the case. Or it could just be they're stunned speechless. Who knows? But I'm pleased. I think it looks very 80s album cover. Now, whether that's a good thing or not to you, that's a whole other thing. But personally, I think, for me anyway, I think that's a very good thing. Crawford says, likes the way the plugs are coming out of her hair. Would like to see the ones in the lower left not be see-through. Would give them depth. Think Crawford is talking about these plugs here, which is interesting. I could go either way on that. I could see pluses on that. I could see minuses, but it's just food for thought. But overall, I think good job, Phil. Thanks for sharing. Who remains to be next? We've had a pretty big exodus of people here. So who is still here? Joe. We've got to do Joe. Hang on 1 second here. Joe, this is a very different look for you, although I can still see the Joe Ramsey look there. I've got to say that is a bad original. Apologies if you took it. But I like this a lot, and you've evolved a bit. It's still got the look of your highlights that I have seen before, but it is not nearly as crunchy. Yakov says it's kind of soft, but if you've actually seen some of Joe's previous work that he submitted, they were almost in the other extreme, crunchy. I'm liking this, but I got to say, Joe, please, speaking as somebody that is sensitive about his own dentation, do this man a favor and fix that tooth for him. You don't need to repair it, just minimize it a little bit, just to be nice to the man. And plus it just kind of draws the eye a little bit. Tom says, nice development of the image. Joe says that he's taken our critiques of his images from a previous show very seriously, and I can see that. And I think this has... I did not think topaz when I opened this. And I kind of like the glowy, soft, but still sharp highlights. I don't even know how to describe it. And the highlights of the iris. I think you are evolving. You might want to consider doing something with the background. I notice you've added that frame there, which is definitely something. But I almost want to see like some little curly cues or something in here. He also does look a little bit like he's sticking his head out at you, which actually it looks like he might be in real life. But I have to say, good job. Larry disagrees with me on the tooth. He loves the tooth. It really works with the stylized feel of the image and the whole wide-angle look. Perhaps, you know, and there are some people that are proud of their little flaws and idiosyncrasy. The mole on their nose or whatever. Who knows? John says he likes the highlights to the face. He looks like a doctor dentist. If this is a dentist, definitely fix that tooth. Otherwise, that's just bad advertising for the gentleman. Joseph assures us that it is not a dentist. But this is a good thing. I don't. There's something about the The gentleman, I have no idea, and pardon me if this is racist, but the gentleman has a little bit of a Middle Eastern look to him. And this color here has a bit of a Moroccan or Moorish feel. And so I want to look in here and see like little curlicues, little paisleys or something. Pardon me if I'm mixing my metaphors here. Joseph says he's Lebanese. I think that qualifies as Middle Eastern, and so I'm not as embarrassed as I could have been. Malcolm suggested it's very Glenn Dewis, which we've done a show for Glenn with Glenn Dewis. We had up on the video rental site. He says that as a compliment. And since I obviously thought enough of Glenn's work to hire him to do one of our shows, I would have to agree there. Don't know if I see that, though, but take that for what it's worth. I also haven't been following Glenn's work for like the last year. But I have to say, Joseph, I really have enjoyed watching your progress, and I have to say, very good job here. Larry says, this is a cool character headshot. The dark border makes the shot too light. Better without it. So, I don't know. Pluses and minuses. People generally agree do something with the background. They disagree what to do with the background. But generally, they say you need to do something with the background. Just for me, find a really intricate paisley pattern, and then drop it in as like a 5% overlay, just so that it's almost not even there. But it's like a little cookie for people that want to stare for more than a minute or two. Let's see. Larry says the dark border makes the shot too tight. Okay, not too light. So apologies for misquoting Larry there. Maybe I could see that, particularly around the top of the head. But I don't know. But regardless, good job. I recommend everybody view all of these previous shows on YouTube. But if you want to see a very good progress of an artist still on the left-hand side of the learning curve, go look at some of our Joe's work and some of our previous audience showcase shows, and you can see how he's taken some of our comments here and incorporated them. But he hasn't lost his own style, which I cannot stress enough. You can still say, I look at this, and you know, even if he didn't sign his work, which I also recommend everyone do, I would say that looks like I wouldn't say that looks like a Glenn Dewis. I would say that looks like a Joe Ramsey. Okay. Thank you, Joe. I appreciate it, and I look forward to seeing what you submit next month. Okay, who is going to be next? Who is Louise? Because I don't even know if Louise is here, but I really like this thumbnail, and I want to see this. I said I wasn't going to do this. If they weren't here, I wasn't going to call on them, but I wanted to see this bigger. We have here, wow, the before and the after, which considering it looks like... Was this seriously resized for... he might have downsampled it, but that looks like a pretty rough iPhone-ish before. Maybe it wasn't. And that's a pretty good after. I have to assume that this line here was not in the... that's the after. That's to be fair. Joseph said it's a little harsh. I can see that. It looks like he's working on like an Amy Dresser type of situation and might have gone a little bit overboard. Also, that hair looks a little bit like a little bit of the Greek Garnus, which if you've been watching our videos, thank you so much. I can see as to how, it needs to be, especially around the eyes and cheeks, it needs to be reeled in just the tattiest bit. Jakob wants to see the before again. Derek says the highlights in the eyes are not balanced. The highlight in the left eye is a bit strong. Plus, there are four lights in the left and only 2.5 in the right. And so you might want to balance out those catch lights. Yakov points out the nose. So you can see it's just, it needs to be a little bit balanced. You did a very good job, and it appears that you have got a good handle on the technique. And if that really was the before you were working for and not a completely resized one just for the show, good job there. But it looks like you do need to work on your balance a little bit. It does look a little bit like her face is kind of pushing out of the image a little bit. It doesn't really quite go with the soft contrast back here. So I would say just reel it in a little bit. I know you've got that final Amy Dresser paint with white technique applied here. I might want to do a little tiny bit less than that. And also, well, she actually does have a pointed chin in real life, so I can't really say too terribly. That's an odd angle. I got to say, I'm sorry if you took that photo, but that is a crap photo to start with. But so considering what you started with, you've come miles. But this does have a little bit of a airbrushy, painty look to it, which might have been exactly what you were going for. John says plastic on the right, but overall nice image. Which, yeah, it does look a little shinier over here. I could see that. Could use a little bit of green, but again, this might have been severely downsized for submission, so we really can't judge too terribly much on that. But I'm not really seeing any poor work there. I'd say you're on the right track. But this looks a little bit airbrushy. This looks a little bit like Sight of the Vanny looking, a little bit more than cover of Vogue, which if that's what you're going for, more power to you. But since you're submitted to retouchpro.com, I assume you're going more for the magazine coverish look, in which case you might want to work on the balance. You might want to work on subtlety, pulling back. Maybe check out a couple of the Chris Tarantino shows we have up on the video site. The man is a master of balance. Let's see here. Does anybody else have any constructive words to be said? Larry says, all that said, still a wow improvement from the original. Yes, so whatever we might say, I hope that's of some use to you, but regardless, wow, that is a big difference from the original. Marvelous. Well, thank you very much, Louise. Okay. Not going to call on anybody else unless they are here right now, because that was kind of painful. Derek, did you finally send the I'm not going to forget about you. I have three images here from you, but they are just the ones that I've already shown. Ah, here we go. From Dick. Oh, he submitted his RAW file, which, that's new. Marvelous. Okay, this is before. And this is after. Okay, are we talking about the black and whiteification of this? Is this what you're talking about the grayscalifying? Yakov says he likes. I do have to say he did a pretty good job with the contrast, the cropping, the edge burning is very good. I'm trying to think, was there anything else at play here? He straightened it. Yeah. So you see, you obviously did a lot of work on this. Also vamping while we get other people's comments on this. Dick, are there any things that we're not addressing here that you were hoping to see us commenting on? For a black and white conversion, I think this is excellent, and I do think you've taken a relatively nondescript snap and done quite a lot with it. I particularly like this line right here. I don't even know why I like it, but I like that a lot. I guess this is particularly poignant nowadays. The more I'm looking at this, the more I'm liking it, especially the way you have drawn out the texture of the marble there. And I do see that you have straightened it considerably. It also appears to be considerably taller now, but I guess it really doesn't matter too terribly much. Joseph's not a fan of the background. What I'm seeing is these stones here and these stones here, and I have to wonder if something couldn't have been done to separate them a little bit and maybe make them contribute something so that this is unknown and then there's an endless line of unknowns behind him or something like this. I don't know. That's just thinking out loud here. But overall, I think you've done a very good job. Larry says he should have left a little bit more room at the bottom. Good black and white conversion. Some of the small black flecks in the headstone could be retouched. That's a judgment call. He might have wanted them there. Tom says, I like the light and shade on the image. The highlights in the background could be toned down a bit. So I'm the only one, evidently, that likes the background here and thinks more could be done with it. Other people are saying you need to hide it more, get rid of that, knock off that one highlight and darken it a little bit more. And you could, that is a pure judgment call. Okay. Well, Seabass. Or Dick, whichever way you prefer to be referred to. Thank you so much for submitting. And I, like I say, the more I look at that, the more I'm enjoying it. I guess if we had more time since you submitted your original RAW file, I could have played with it. But personally, I would have just run Silver Effects on it, and I don't have that installed right now. Okay, Derek, you're killing me. I really want to get to your image, but I am only seeing I'm still seeing the Asian couple and the black couple, and I'm not seeing the before of the one or the after of the other. Oh, there we go. Wait a second. Here we go. We are in business now. Thank you, Derek. Look at this. Don't you just love having a live show? Here is Derek's before. Here is Derek's after. Gone with the wind here. Before. After. Yakov says abfab, which I have to assume is you're Eastern European for absolutely fabulous. Malcolm says, cool. I'm just going to toggle a couple more times to let people drink that in. Am I wrong thinking in cut of Gone with the Wind? I don't... very Tara-esque. Let's see, Yakov, yes, I know Abfab was a British show. I actually watched it. Joseph says, very good, but the couple stands out better in the original. Now, that's an interesting point. Is this overly dramatic? Did we make this so dramatic that the couple is actually being lost? And you got to remember, in wedding photos, trust me, to heck with the couple. The most important part is the bride. Have we made this so dramatic that we've actually are now detracting from the bride? Chambers Major says, good idea to replace the sky, but the models don't stand out as well in front of the clump of dark clouds. Well, that's an interesting thought. You're going to add a cloud, or, you know, move the cloud over so that they're over here instead of on the by the dark, you know, because we do have the darker skin tones against the darker clouds. John says, what about bringing the couple forward? Well, I mean, anything's possible, but I have to assume that some decisions were made during the shooting. Malcolm says the leaves are the only part that look false, which is interesting because they're in the original. Are you talking about these leaves here? Larry says the masking on the little tree shrub of the right stands out. Good job blending the lighting. So Larry's pointing out, are you talking about shrub on the right? Are you talking about these over there? Oh, good job getting rid of that flag stuck in the ground, too. I just now noticed that. I don't think anybody would say you did anything other than an excellent job on this, although some people are saying that there might be a couple of things that are distracting. And I think everything boils down to maybe it's just a little too dramatic. But I don't know. If I saw this as a 24 by 30 hanging over the fireplace, maybe this wouldn't look too dramatic. And if you are a wedding photographer looking to sell enlargements, etc., that might be just the ticket. Or if they're looking for something that they want to play on their big screen TV, I have done some weddings in the past, but it was, I actually shot film that lets you know how long ago it was. And so I don't know, do we even have prints hanging on the walls anymore, or do they just have a folder on their PlayStation that they call up and view on their LED big screen nowadays? Derek says, yes, it's made to be a big print. And so I suspected the same. I got to wonder, how do you, and this has nothing to do with nothing, but I got to wonder how you proof stuff like this in the, to sell them the big print. Do you actually show this on a big, enormous monitor and then say, I'm going to print this like on linen and put fake brush strokes on it or something? Derek says, he shows it on his big LCD. Yes, he has it in his studio. And the final print size was going to be 20 by 30. Okay, so I wasn't too terribly far off. But good job. We don't mean to nitpick, and obviously you've already sold this, and so the customer is already happy with it. And so we are just going to, we're gilding your lily. And hey, you asked us to, you uploaded. And I'm just pleased as punch that we were finally able to show your images. Thank you so much, Derek. Okay, who is next? Whose images can I lose next? I don't know if Greg is here or not, but I am dying to see this. Greg, are you with us today? Like I'm holding a seance. Are you with us? First of all, that is an adorable looking steer, cow, bull. What is that? And now, this is what Greg has done with it. Well, unfortunately, people are saying the same thing. It looked a little bit more realistic as a thumbnail. Because he's floating in the air here. He needs a shadow. Yes, Crawford calls this levitating steer is the title of the image. John says, yes, he looks like he's flowing. He's floating. He needs a shadow. Yep. But considering where you started, let's pretend said steer has a shadow. Are there shadows on other layers here? Ooh, this is cool. Now, I like that. He doesn't even need a shadow there. Now, this is fun. I wish everybody submitted stuff like this. Not his style, but I mean with all the layers that I can play with. Oh, this is cool. What does layer 7 do? Oh, that's just a signature. Kind of defeats the purpose. If I can turn your signature off, I guess he trusts me. A little subtle look there. Oop! That's fascinating. Post-apocalyptic cow. I could do this all day. John says scale him down a bit, which I don't know, might defeat the. I like this one better. Sorry, maybe it's because of the lack of levitation. I got to revert this because I think I messed it up. No, he needs a shadow, or he needs to be a faux painting. I like this a lot. I'm not a fan of faux painting. Anybody that looks at my website knows that I am not a big fan of faux painting, but I like this one. That was turned off, so maybe this was the way it was supposed to look. We don't know. You're not here, so we can say anything we want. Brian says it also, the painting improves the horizontal cutout. Now, this might be like what we were talking about earlier on the composite we were looking earlier about the texture blending together disparate component parts. And so maybe the painting here, rather than being a good thing on its own, which I'm not going to say it's not, but the painting is acting as a texture to combine the disparate component parts, like a grunge filter or a film grain or a noise or whatever on a regular composite. I don't know. Oh, Greg is here. Excellent, Greg. Sorry, I didn't mean to wake you up. There is a shadow layer. Where is the shadow layer? Am I missing the shadow layer? Oh, Larry has an interesting point. He says, remember seeing a RetouchPRO with Steve adding a little dust cloud at the feet of one of his animal composites would work great here. I don't know if he's really moving that fast, but yes, that's very definitely something which could work here. Greg, can you remember which layer had the shadow on it? Because I'm not seeing it. That's an interesting effect. Maybe the shadow layer just didn't ship with, maybe this is an older version. Ah, okay, the contact shadow only. So he did put a shadow in here, but he did it a little, at least for the audience's sake anyway, he did it a little lighter, a little smaller than he intended. Now, Greg, which, is this the final, is this your intended final version, or turned off versions, are these your final ones, or were these only sent in for our own edification? Which one do you consider the final image? Yakov says he wants me to actually burn the shadow in right now, and seriously, you would hate it if I did that, because I am so rusty at this stuff, isn't it? You'll understand. The final is second from the so we were right. This is the final. Okay, excellent. So our judgment is not all that terribly far off. And considering that he starts out, I got to assume that this is Austin or someplace like that, or someplace west of the Pecos. This is interesting. You got to... So the signature is KT, so you did not take this. KT took this. Okay, that's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. Marvelous, marvelous. Well, I'm glad we got to see this, and I'm glad you were there to correct me. Thank you very much. Thanks, Greg. And just to let everybody know, yes, I will think better of your work if you include all the layers for me to play with in the future, but just upload it the day before, otherwise it will take forever. Okay, who is next? I'll keep on going until everybody is... I've still got a zillion pictures to look at, but I'm only going to look at the ones that are there here with us to appreciate our comments. Is there anybody still with us that we have not looked at your pictures yet? Malcolm says yes. Does that mean okay? Does that mean we still have some of your pictures? I have a Malcolm before. Do I have a Malcolm after? Yes, I do. Okay, here's Malcolm's before. Pleasant looking in lady. Here's Malcolm's final. Okay, pretty straightforward retouch. Let's try to get them. This is totally unfair, I know, guys. But let's do this. Okay, what does everybody have to say about Malcolm's work? Jakob says you need to lighten the gum between the first teeth. So I guess he's talking about right here, which is exactly the way it is in the original. It's kind of like in the dentist, or not the dentist, the doctor image we were looking at before. It's not necessarily realistic, but you're doing a little bit of a favor for the person. So don't fix it, but just maybe minimize it. John says, nice job overall. Jakob said he would have darkened the eyelashes a little bit. Well, I don't know. That's a judgment call because I know the dark eyelashes and all that. That is I got to assume she's a woman, she's wearing makeup. If she wanted dark eyelashes and dark eyeliner, she would have applied it herself. She didn't. So I could see that. I got to wonder, the teeth look a tad blue. And the whites of the eyes look a little shiny. I got to say, they did a really good job. I just got to wonder if it's not just the tattiest bit overdone. But zooming in here, it does appear that you're going more for a painterly feel than a retouch feel, in which case that is all fine. Gregory says he likes that you didn't overdo the wrinkle removal. Tom says the skin looks too smooth. Again, possible. Jakob says especially in the forehead. It's possible if this is meant to be a retouch. Malcolm, you'll have to tell us. Is this a retouch or is this a photo art? Is this a retouch or is this a faux painting? And if it is supposed to be just a retouch, then the fact that we are confusing it as a faux painting lets you know something is amiss. You've gone a little overboard, I think, perhaps, maybe. If you just overlaid this on this and then turned down the opacity to like 90% or whatever, that might be one thing. I think you've done a good job. I think you just need to pull back a tad. I don't see really anything to comment here. I think it's just a little, the volume is at 11 here. I think the volume needs to be at about 9. Bring back a little touch of line. Don't bring back the line, just a little touch. The ones under the eyes, now that's a fair comment. You could get rid of the ones under the eyes because a lot of times those are caused by the act of being photographed. You smile, it accentuates the bags under the eyes. They wouldn't even be there if you weren't having your picture taken. So I think those are fair game. But the lines on the forehead and the lines around the mouth and all that, those are hard earned. Those are earned. Those are experience lines. And so they need to have those hints stayed in there. And the teeth and the eyes, a good job on them, but maybe just a little bit blue or a little bit too pronounced. They need to be just the tattiest bit yellow to look real. Let's see here. David says needs more gradients in foreheads and cheeks. Larry says the wisps of the hair near the chin look odd and could be removed. But I think he's talking about these right here. But now we are getting to purely to Phillips and filigrees. I don't think anybody has disagreed with me yet. Yeah, Jakob says nobody's using D&B anymore. Fair point, and I deliberately didn't even bring that up. This is, you know, this looks a little bit, does look a little bit on the filtered side. Didn't want to bring that up in case he spent a week working D&B on this, and I said it looked like a filter. Jakob, if you look at any of our the real shows we have on our video site, you'll know that we are big proponents of D&B. Virtually every one of our shows promote that as really the only real way of doing that. Okay. And now we're getting a bunch of people in the audience saying, I use D&B, I use D&B. Good for you guys. Okay. Filters bad, D&B good. But Malcolm, I think you did a really good job. You just need to be a little bit more realistic, a little bit less plastic. Just dial it back a degree or two, and I think you'll be on the money. Marvelous. Okay, and then I saw somebody else say, do me, in there, and then I passed them up. Stuff scrolls so fast when the comments start. Okay, Tom Burns, here we go. Okay, here's his original. And he's titled this photo painting, so we will not say filter whenever this pops up, okay? Whoa, I will not say filter. Marvelous. Oh, now, I am not a fan of photo paintings. But wow, that is cool. You did not just run a filter over it. Or hell, you may have run all sorts of filters over it. I don't know, but it certainly doesn't look like it because the proportions have changed. And the edges are burned. You've got a faux frame here, which that's another thing that I'm not a big fan of, but in this case it does seem to work. Jakob says his standards are way too high. Then Jakob, you need to submit more or talk to me. We'll do a show starring Jakob. This is for a show for every interest level and every experience level. At least the audience showcase shows are. No one has anything else to share for Tom? I'm a big fan of this. I like this. I like how he took the time to make the blurry brushes around here. Larry says, what is the sharp line on the flower on our left? The sharp line on the flower on our left. I'm not seeing any sharp lines. Help me out here, Larry. This line here? Running vertical. This line here? Wow. I'm not seeing. I'm getting some miscellaneous comments. Art is vertical. The only thing I got to say, and you can't really say anything because it happened in nature, but this line being continued here kind of makes us look like two images kind of glued together a little bit. I might have considered offsetting those or changing them entirely. A line going real fine through the red flower. I'm sorry, but I'm not seeing it. I got to wonder if it's not a webinar artifact or I'm just missing what you're talking about. David doesn't like this line right here. So if we ask people to nitpick, they can nitpick, but overall people are not nitpicking. A couple people are politically averse to the genre, which is no reflection on this particular image. Larry says it went away when I zoomed, so it was a webinar thing. Okay, cool. I say good job. Good job. David says, otherwise, beautiful. Marvelous. Well, and you did the edges are dark, so I slightly, so I got to say good job there. And like I say, I am not a fan of the genre. I am not a fan of faux painting. I do not like faux painting. I will not, you know, criticize somebody for doing it. I just am not a fan of it myself. But I like this one. I like the way this looks. So take that for what it's worth. Thank you, Tom. Is anybody remaining that has an image that we have not yet covered? There's a couple here that I have fascinating looking thumbnails. Still waiting. Is anybody else here with an image? Here's another Malcolm. We're only supposed to submit one, but this is the final. This, I don't have the original, so I really can't say much about this. Certainly a pleasant enough image. Don't have the before, so I really can't say too terribly much about it. Okay, well, Malcolm, plus you've already had your moment in the sunshine, so thank you for submitting. It's a pleasant-looking image, but we really don't have all that much to say about it. Let's see. Let's get to Eleanor's here. Where's Eleanor's? Because she's been very helpful with her comments, and I would feel very, very bad if I did not. We did not get to see her image. Ooh, fascinating. We have here either a composite or the world's best junkyard. I've got to assume this is a composite. What do we have to say of Eleanor's picture? Yaakov is pointing out in his inimitable way that it does tend to look a little bit flat. It does look a bit planar, shall we say. Floating, that's another word for it. So that is, I would say that is a valid comment. Floating cars. That very well could have been the point, but I suspect it might not have been the point, especially since they're MGs. Oh, Yaakov is just enjoying this, but he's saying he's just typing in puns on floating cars. It's not an unpleasant image, but I do seem to, I do think that it is, it's lacking a unification. It's lacking a, it kind of looks like an MG mugshot, a really well-done MG mugshot, which is, you know, something to be said on itself, but I don't really know. It appears that it aspires to, like, poster territory, like a couple of those, like the Lamborghinis and like that. Phil says maybe done a clouds overlay. Maybe I could see something. I could see there. Yeah, you do have a possibility here of doing something to differentiate, to add some depth, to maybe make this drop back a little bit further, or maybe separate these a little bit, or maybe get rid of the grass here so that it's not quite so grounded in reality and it doesn't look like somebody's dropping the MGs on each other. John says, what about a panorama with all the views on the same plane? That's a possibility. Larry says it's an interesting way to show several angles and details. Well, now that's one thing. Larry immediately registered that this was the same car three different ways. Honestly, I was taking it as three separate cars. So I don't know if that says anything about anything. Now I feel kind of silly because this obviously is the same one three times. I think I've got a new fan with Yaakov. I just made his day. He's actually typing in the ha-ha-ha's at how stupid I am. Eleanor says this was created for the car owner. Was the car owner pleased? Well, I'm sure he loves his car. He obviously takes excellent care of his MG, and he owns an MG. You're not going to own an MG if you do not love your car. Malcolm says suggests this would sell well on eBay. I assume he's talking about your poster, not the car. The car goes without saying. Eleanor says, yes, he bought another car for the same treatment of Corvette. Excellent. Excellent. So do not take any of our notes here as criticisms. Merely take them as points for thought. David suggests put the red, white, and blue a little bit out of focus. Looks like that has already been done just a tad, maybe done a little bit more. We're going to basically either do something to make it look a little bit more photography, a little bit more composite-y, or do something to make it look a little bit more postery. Either, you know, right now it's kind of got a foot in both camps, and it looks, I don't know, just a little bit confusing. So either get rid of the grass and make it three floating cars, or do something to, I don't know. These are just things to ponder, but I would say good job. I like that, and I like that background a lot myself. Marvelous. Well, thank you very much, Eleanor. I hope some of our notes were of some value. Do we have anyone else still in the audience that has images we have not looked at yet? Had a couple people complain that and left, but honestly, I'm working with, these are all the images I'm working with. I still have about 20 images, but you're not here. We don't talk about you. Sorry. Marvelous, marvelous. Well, we're okay. We're almost at the two-hour mark anyway. So let's see. Let's find an interesting image to leave on. I don't even know what this is, but it's just some visual interest as we are departing. I want to thank everyone for sticking with us. Don't forget, I hate to beg, but seriously, I need you guys' help. If you can become a patron or send a PayPal donation or whatever, I just pasted in our address, paypal@retouchpro.com, because it may not look like it, but these shows are incredibly expensive to put on the software. Picture buying a licensed version of Photoshop every month. Just to give you an idea of the scale here, and considering that I got, as I said, three donations so far since the last show a month ago, you can see the deficit there. So I am really grinding through my savings doing these shows. I really need your help. Don't forget to view our our real shows, but if you go to retouchpro.com, go to the videos. Yakov, watch a few of these videos and criticize them. Ha ha. This is where you will see the famous dodge and burn techniques and things along those lines. This is where you see the start to finish professional retouching jobs. A little bit different. Yakov, yes, Yakov brings up a good point. We lost a dear friend last week. Greg Garnas passed. And, pardon me, I'm still, it does bother me a little bit. We shall be missed. There's a thread on our forum with the details of her memorial service. And feel free to look at that. If you live in the London area, you can go to her memorial service, which is going to be on April 18th. And Yaka reminds everybody, yes, rent her videos, buy her books. We have a couple of videos on our own site. She definitely will be missed. All right. Well, now I'm bummed out for the rest of the day. Thank you for reminding me, Yaakov. But, consider becoming a patron, rent our videos. I already have another one of these shows scheduled for next month. Definitely we'll have that one. Already have some our guest artist shows lined up for the upcoming month. We've got, of course, our old friend Steve Kaplan. We've got Dennis Dunbar, another one, and we've got a couple more ideas. Have a couple of feelers put out for some brand new people. But like I say, need your help if we're going to keep these going. I was not able to get that big check from Epson. I was not able to get X-Rite on as a sponsor. I was not able to talk any of the other big-ticket people into saying, yes, we support the retouching community. Yes, we think, those people should thank us for the amount of business that we send them. But, like I say, whenever they find out that we're only talking about dozens or hundreds of people as opposed to hundreds of thousands of people, they stop answering my emails. And so I'm going to have to rely on you guys. If you're not a member of RetouchPRO, register and post. Go down to our salon. See, we already have a post here from New Guy that we love hearing from you. This is the best retouching community on the internet. There might be some with a few more members. There might be some with a few more posts, but there is none better. There is none more supportive or warmer with a better mix of professional and beginner. All right, guys. Well, thank you so much for showing up. Thank you for sharing. And I'll see you in the forums. Bye-bye, everyone.